to open the paper session in front seat or room seat for today's first three talks will be about moving state. The next two ones will be about, well, let's say network internals. My talk will be about making practical use of all of these new features that are being constantly added to moving state. Using here is a well-known gap, and maybe not so well-known routing device that was added 3 years ago or something. And, well, not many people took notice of it, so I decided to make a talk how to actually use it, which tools are capable of working with routing domains, which are not on monthly yet, and how to do that for a multi-tenancy firewall. Where a tenant can be either several customers, or maybe you're trying to connect multiple campuses on your university, or it's just different lifecycle ages of your application being a tenant. I'm technical lead at SysFireWall, which is a Unix shop, providing application support from an empty rack to a full-scale integration on the application level, like connecting doing the services, time-stamping, anything else, including growing across multiple racks, growing across multiple countries, doing disaster recovery, for example, AWS and so on. We are now a small shop with 10 people, but we are still growing. We are hiring, but you need to help. Being able to talk some German to the applicator. I'm using computers for quite a while, and OpenBSD for over 15 years now. And I'm trying to be a developer in that arena, but, well, work didn't permit so much time that was required, so it was disabled, but later I'm coming back to that. So what I am talking about today? If you have several tenants that should be isolated from each other, you can do that with PF only, but there is well, a lot of pitfalls that you can jump into, and then you might have a very bad day. And I will show what domains are in itself, how they are to be set up, and I'll show you also some of the details for configuration, the typical pitfalls you likely will run into, and how you can debug them. And so that you don't have to be drying out routing domains in your real environment, because if you do that, it would be a very bad day. I will show you an easy way how to set up a virtual nice environment with an automatic configuration and provisioning of this nested environment, so you can just use that. And well, within something like 15 to 20 minutes, you have a fully capable routing domain set up and try out these features, and you don't have to mess around with like configurations or in your box, which will from me, from the outside. This talk and all the used virtualization environment and so on is already on GitHub. On here. So if you want to read back or forth already, you can download the PDF from here. About our company, we are using OpenBSD quite a lot. We have well, several locations. Each of those hexagons is a location. Physically different from each other, and the red bars are hexagons in between, and that's spanning like from Hamburg in North Germany down to Gibraltar and the Mediterranean Sea. So it's a very distributed setup, and having each of those it is a physical networking domain, and to interconnect all of these without having hassles of overlapping having a lot of physical networks, you likely want to have segregation of all the networking services you typically have. And so even with a, well, let's say, single application with all its life cycles, if you're using isolated services, there's, well, even with that, already quite a number of interfaces around, like for ours, a bit over 40, and even the basic rule set has already 300 lines, plus something like relay using 30 rules inside that as well. So, like I said, in the simple setups, using quite a lot of network. So even if you use a dedicated firewall, like one physical box, or better two, with card, to have the redundancy, we are having a lot of interfaces and integrations to external services like payment or spending services, legal stuff like timestamping authorities and so on. As you can see, my digital drawing skills are not that good, so I'm using just whiteboard screenshots. I think it will work too and saves me a lot of time to research presentations. Any questions so far? Okay, if you're trying to deal with that without looping domains, you will have to be very, very careful in creating your dev.conf, because all the ordering, especially for anything doing that, in whichever direction, can easily bring you into problems. And maybe you have that one, well, firewall hacker or whatever, doing really cool rule sets, and he understands it fully. And then you try to adapt something, maybe at a call at 3 a.m. because something stopped working, and then you're messing around with the configuration, and well, whatever might happen, you cannot test it beforehand. And you are likely having a thing that is worse than before you have tried to fix it. If you're using templates for, like, we have a customer, new customer, and he will use typical services, so he has access to maybe an internal DNS or main service, databases and so on. And you might either include that or do it in cut and paste more or less. And then you likely will have to adapt this template. So we are not doing it consistently, but you can give it turn configs. And one of the other traditional solutions would be like using just another pair of boxes for the custom. And then it starts for your support team to decide, yeah, well, which box is handling which customer. It's always documentation drama. IPv4 is, well, dying in availability. So if you need even more transparency on the public space, there will be more and more of a problem. I think what's the cost of the transfer? I don't know, €1,000, $1,000. So that's not, that's a problem already. And also you have to have enough right space. I mean, you could do firewalling in a VM, but I do not recommend it. And if you're using physical boxes, it's not that uncommon that a customer would pop up and like, yeah, well, can we start tomorrow or at lunch? And it will be quite a task to be quick enough to launch that physically, having the network assigned and so on. Also, if the customers are growing, you might need additional firewalls for further segmentation for throughput, like you just can have so many 10 gigabit Ethernet on one box and so on. changing maybe the complete location and so on, and then you have to read all the physical stuff maybe quite again. The Greek thing seemed like I said, if you're doing something like 2 a.m. in the morning or in a rush at all, you might have to debug that for a very long time. And given the way how the app works, well, it would be too long that you can fix the things. What also happened with us was that one tenant was buying the app, and we had this nice thing like, oh, we are using all the same IP and those prefix. So you have to map you from the RDR to any other direction, and the ordering in the airport is rather more challenging. Peter has done a talk in 2015, isn't it? It's linked on the last slide. If you are acting like an ISP, where you cannot control the outside at all, routing domains can help very much there too. But that's not the scope of this talk. So if you are in that situation, you might run into Peter's talk too. But this one will help you as well. Who's missing you? So that should represent physical firewalls. And what routing domains actually are is having one physical box, like here, and then not having, well, dedicated firewalls but routing domains. So it's just putting multiple firewalls or routers by itself into one physical box, and then it's easy to extend for more tenants because we are only adding virtualized environments. So all the thing about physicals is not a problem. Or if you are having one firewall right now, but you want to segregate it, then you can just add additional routing domains to it. So how do I get routing domains in all our Ericoon? Just compose by putting an interface into such a routing domain. The details will be shown later. And with establishing the routing domain, each tenant has its own routing channel that's totally isolated. So if you have overlapping IP addresses, that's not a problem at all. Most of the tools in OpenBSD are totally aware of routing domains, where they need to. And there are some which are not fully integrated yet. You can have the daemon services like Nginx, most things, and then OPLACE and just starting distinct routing domains. To connect them, you can either use PF to shuttle packets from one routing domain to the next, or using a new functional interface for PF. Then, like I said, PF can do it. Also, and interesting routing domains has some new limits, but not many, and they are fixable. So far, so good. I was sifting through all of the OpenBSD source code and web pages to figure out which tools support routing domains, and which option or whatever prefix form and so on is provided. So there's a typical network setup and well, debugging, retrieving information, stuff like that, to root R thing trace through, which are either using capital T or capital V. It's not consistent because, well, just running out of characters in the options, like, as we already used, I think capital V works the first in the big part, and then other tools have that already taken, so It differs a bit, but we are trying to have it at least in a small set and not every tool having its own option character for supporting units. Especially interesting later on is PS, where you can use a minus OR table to see in which routing domain that process was started. All the starting works are transpatient. So further operations people and practice get rid of also what it might use it. If you're really doing that, so FTP proxy has a support, but it's best way to say about it, it's really ugly. And don't use FTP. I have no slide about how to do that. I have been even trying to figure it out because I propose as FTP or as if you're doing FTP, take the pain yourself. Other routing demons. Other routing demons are having full support for routing domains, but it's a quite complicated thing. And if you're in that arena, well, each of the demons would more or less fill its own core. RPF is limited. I will come to that later on. Also, showing it in more detail for relay, RCCTL, NTPD, that's a funny thing one. And of course, I have conflict and corresponding hosting that I have. So that's the list of tools that have, well, let's say, built-in routing domain support. It's not more, because it's not more needing it. I'm sorry about the feedback, but we're kind of suppressive. So if you have demons, or like, let's say, NX or HDD, whichever, or in that example, IP, and you want to have VPN support in different routing domains, you can just use root with the capital T, the routing domain number, and then just start it within that routing domain. And the only network IP can see is that of the routing domain 23, and the second one can only see that of 42. So they're completely distinct from each other in network configuration. If you have demons that are sharing information or writing and reading to from the kernel, or maybe files or something, you have to be careful that you have a configuration that is different, because otherwise you might have problems with something like reloading a service or actually stopping it if both demons are writing in the same PID files or the last people make and so on. Difficult things. NTPD is its own story. Additional picture. Yeah, limits. There are, by default, there is only 255 additional routing domains. It says 256 because even if you are not using routing domains at all, the kernel doesn't. The default networking you're using now on OpenBSD is routing domain 0. Then you can add 255 more. If you really think you need more, you can do that with changing the value in sys/socket.h. And you have to do not only a kernel rebuild, but the full use manual to catch up with all the tools I have listed previously. Then CARP has the problem, so to say, that its parent device must be in the same routing domain. If you have something like a test bed, or maybe only a very small device like an older series 8 between U1 and more or less you are running out of physical parallel interfaces. You can put in virtual interfaces in between, break up this little limitation and even reach that as well. And I've identified that some of the daemons that should or have to support moving domains are not fully there. The first is RPF, where I can use different anchor names in the configuration to have a separated configuration of it. But at the same time, it would read from the same configuration path, so you have no chance to have distinct configurations per domain running RPF instance of this. That's fixable. I will try to provide it later in the year. IP has only that limitation so far that I cannot configure a socket name. That's not a problem as long as you don't need to talk to it via IXCTL. If you're doing that all by hand and killing, and then you could use it already. And adding the option to have a configurable socket name, yeah, it's not that much of a problem, but no one did it yet. It was lost in some rush. The interesting part is that IXCTL already has an option to use different socket, but there's no one reading it. Relay has already a support if you're using a rootless feature. I didn't know it even existed. I was using that anyway. It's like a very exotic thing for a friend. But the more typical use is using relays, where Relay is manipulating the RDR rules given the log check is true or false to enable failover compensation and so on. And I'm working on a fix for that, and I have more detailed things for that as well. Third party imports or whatever, I don't know, like I have said, the options and the configuration must be such that you can have fully distinct running instances like Docker and Git. Pair is a new Ethernet interface that will allow you to connect routing domains to each other if you need to have that. So you can directly route between the routing domains or routing domain 0 as well. If you need it, it's not mandatory, and I can detail on that. That's an introduction into virtual domains, so now I can give all the details. Any questions before that? Yes.
Sorry. How is the loopback interface added to the
loss
domain?
Nope. The loopback is just like the other interface, and I'm showing that in our ad config example. Because it works for any interface that is manipulatable with IF config, it can be done the same. Loopback has no special handling case. Doesn't know.
Yeah, recently. So now I think the loopback is created when you create an argument. That's only in the current.
Really?
Yeah.
It's still kind of broken.
Anyway, you can create one and push it in the routing domain you want to have. only a quick, we have more details on, that's the introduction, sorry. And DEFCON syntax will be either for the in-path, like you have coming in on routing domain 21. And if you are pushing out packets into a given existing routing domain, you're the RTAP equivalent. It's there, it's different for only historic reasons, but barely inside the kernel there's a distinct handling about what is a routing domain, what is RTAP, or a routing table, but you can fix an anchor in a routing domain and using RJ for an anchor as well. That's just to show the syntax and details page right away. Okay, so the question was, how do I actually put an interface into a routing domain to commose one? Of course, you can do it just by hand. I have config, vlan, pipe, R domain, and you are. And then the interface will pop into that routing domain. And the one problem is if you try to, well, let's say, live migrate an existing interface with its existing IDE6 configuration. When you're doing that, then you will eventually lose your connectivity for at least a brief moment, because the kernel will drop the IDE6 configuration when it's put into a different domain. Essentially, that would happen the same way. You're using a hostname.if and put the domain keyword below the IDE configuration. And you do sh etc net start vlan41. Then you will end up with a vlan41 interface in that group, within that vlan, with that description, but you won't have any IDE configuration. So be careful. And for the typical families, more or less, of interfaces, not BSD, it's always the same thing. And you have been asking about localhost, whatever, 31 or so. You can just do it the same thing. There's no special anything. Unless I don't know, will this include the default routine with that auto created loopback interface?
So,
where does that come?
So, on my laptop, I have two arguments, I have arguments 0 and 1, and I have a loopback interface that are 1 and argument 1. Mm-hmm. And I think used to be the case that there was no loopback by default.
Yeah.
And this is really confusing because then you start applications and they don't work.
Yeah.
And so you have to explicitly add loopback to the argument. And I think right now it's like you create the argument, you put some interface into the argument gets created, and then you get loopback interface with the number of arguments.
Okay. So that's current stuff. You said it's wrong. So maybe not Facebook.
There's some funkiness with it creates the IP6 localhost colon 1, but if you create destroy it's two weird states.
Yeah. And no connected route, so that was the next one will still apply.
Yeah.
That's why I was asking about it. Yeah, now having it in doing it for real with pair, you can add a pair interface into the routing domain you want to connect. That's your pair 0 for argument 0. By the way, you don't have to have matching numbers here, so that could be interface pair 5 and being in argument 0. But maybe you don't want to do that because then. Yeah, maybe easy for the brain. But there's no, it's not mandatory to have it like that. And then you can just make a virtualized matching between those two interfaces. And if you add a routing, then you can pass packets between those two routing domains without even having to deal with PF to pass the packet from one routing domain to the next, unless you have a problem. So if you're doing that by hand, you will end up with a few from Routing domain 21 is looking at that, and IF config has been changed so that you can see what's the remote end of your patch cable in the kernel. And the corresponding routing table showing that which part is going on in each interface. So it's just like any other interface out there as well. It's just adding direct connection inside your kernel. Got it. Please use RCCTL. I am one of those previously doing tracking in rc.com.local, and it's getting a pain. No, please use RCCTL, and to manage your events, and it has support for booting domains as well. As shown, you can just say HTTP, enable it, and then you can put it into our table 21 or whichever you like to start it. And using the new output volume R table, you will see that the daemon was started in booting domain 21, which is the same effect like if you do it manually with root -2.1 exit HTTP, that would result in the same process handling. Very easy. Now for intermediate, like I've said, events are writing or sharing information via the kernel or via other files or apps, then you can have very interesting results. And the BD, if you start multiple NTP demons with root -D21 active NTPD and 4.2 and so on, your clock will go haywire, totally. Within 30 seconds work clock time, the clock in the kernel would be like 2 years in, 2 years in the future or in the back. And with the next 10 seconds flipping over, so don't do that. And BD has been patched to be able to run as a single instance, but providing the timing information on different routing domains. I never taken that example because, as I said, routing domains are distinct IP ranges, so if you have clients in routing domain 69, they're running localhost, but then you need to have it on a correct localhost and not on environment 0 to duplicate that. Otherwise, you won't see any kind of information in routing domain 69 for that. So, easy? So, BFConf, I have hidden a little botlet in there, you might see it already, in the all-in-one thingy, to show how important watering is, especially for everything about match or pass rules with .2 or RDR2. Because if a packet matches a rule, it will be rewritten immediately, and a subsequent rule might not match any number. What would be happening here is that the second rule will never match, because the first rule is already rewriting the source address. And so the second one won't match progress. And so if you have to support multiple tenants, you are adding new match rules, you always have to think about, well, at what position in the configuration file, you have to include the batch rule. So it won't influence any other batch rule from another tenant because they might get angry at you. But you have two tenants, two customers that may be being actually competitors. So you're changing the rule set for one customer, disabling more or less, in effect, the rule set for the other one. That will give you a very bad day. So with rooting domains, what you can do is that you have an anchor, and you bind it to a rooting domain, and if a second or subsequent anchor is a different rooting domain. So a packet comes in rooting domain 21, and it will see these two rules, and it won't see this rule ever. Completely isolated. The other way around is packets from rooting domain 41 coming in will only hit this match rule, and the other rule set is completely invisible and won't be used. So that's the easiest part in PF, completely have distinct configurations. And then you can say, I'm doing something for tenant 41, and it had me really, really confident that it won't affect the tenant 41. That's the point here. No more thinking about it, just add more rules with that anchor, and the other tenants won't be affected for sure. Question on that? Nothing will happen. The kernel, if a packet is incoming on this example routing domain 21, and not having, for example, this here, absolutely nothing will happen. The packet will just thrown away. Because even before PF is asked for any processing, the kernel will do a routing lookup, and if there's no root, packet dropped straight away. So if you are playing with that, always keep that in mind, and that's why I was asking if there's an automatic loopback, maybe that could be added too. Maybe as an option. Well, probably not an option there, but anyway. another thing, if you are just playing with it and you are adding, you can only add and if you are reusing while testing the same automation over and over again, and it's working, and then you reboot and your persistent configuration, it might stop working. Because it was working because you had something like that before your second try and so on. So you have been reliant on a previous testing configuration that was still live in kernel. So if it's out, reboot. And rebooting is easier if you're testing in a virtualized testing environment, which I'll talk about later. Like I already said, if you add automate later on, the line configuration will be removed and you have to be added. If you're using bridges with a pair device, please do it only this way, with SDB enabled from the first second, because the packets will move in a loop so fast, you won't be able to type in a second IF config. The box will be using one of the CPU in the kernel, and if it's not virtualized, you're into chicken. Paint and tracer, I was dropping into that several times. Like, I know that whenever like 10.10.42 is only for 10.42, and I'm using the byte address option for ping. Ping won't figure out, oh, there's only one interface with that IP address, so I will change it in the routing domain. It will just say I don't have that IP address. Then you are looking in the IF config, hey, it's there, but it's in the wrong routing domain. So you always have to pass the appropriate option in the routing domain you want to start from. IT, like I said, non-choosable subject, ICTL has it, okay, I've already said. Another one is if you are using multiple ISOPMP or IT instances, you need additional encryption and encapsulation interfaces each pair automate you are using, or nothing will happen. You need encapsulating interface within that routing. Already talked about that. CARP needs its parent device, its CARP dev, within the same routing domain. And if you are short, who's not, physical interfaces, in production environments, you might have retail configuration anyway as a parent device for CARP. But you, in your testing lab or whatever, you don't have Mino in support, or it's maybe too much of a hassle to mess with that. You can use Weaver and Bridge, as shown here, and then you will have more or less like a break of that requirement that CARP is actually using EF1. From both routing domains. full IF config, output and so on, or full header. I guess because it's a bit longer, I want to try to place a lot of slides here. Got that? Or
question about it?
Because that's like a tricky thing. No?
Okay.
Yeah, after finding out,
it's easy.
Finding out the way was like 4 weeks or something to get it really work. Yeah, now for relay. The lag insofar is you cannot choose the anchor name. And you can work around that a bit if you are naming your redirect names properly. But the moment you are not reloading relay, but restarting it, everything will be flushed anyway. So it's a, for some cases you can work with the current relay, but usually not. Same is with not choosing the socket, open configurable one. So relays, if you start the second relay, it will overwrite or recreate the socket. And if you run relayctl, it will only see last started relay instance. Routers has full support by itself, but who's using it? And you can start relaying with root or ST21xx. And then it will be contained into that one routing domain. But because of the previous limitations, you cannot start a second one. So you could have a routing domain 0 and a relay only routing domain where you start relaying, and that would work. But, yet another routing domain couldn't be really added. So while I was working on a diff, trying to have it the easy way, just giving it a command line option to choose a subnet name and minus A option like with the FCTL, I have a different anchor name. Problem with that, it works for starting, stopping and starting, but if you use relayctl reload, well, do silly things with my name, because the way the internal configuration reloading of relay is working, it's complicated, like everything here. I was telling you about that, I have to work on that, so it will be added as a config option into relay.conf or whichever config file you're using, and the command line option will go away because it's not persistent over reloads. I've added also an rtable keyword for relay.conf where a table lookup, like down here, would be done in that R table, and the checks will be only in that R domain, and that's usable for itself. So the typical case would be to pass packets from one routing domain to the next, and it will work out before. Okay, but that's still work in progress. But if you want to try it, but I don't recommend it, it's also not there. Okay, and if you really want to do that, trying to work with virtual domains, I have automation toolbox which you can use. It's using Vagrant, Packer, and Ansible. Vagrant is an easy way to have your OS6 machine spinning up virtual or VMware boxes with a very good defined networking and VM layout. Packer to create the image below it, and Ansible to provision etc.hostname.vnr5 and so on. And what you will get in the end is a testbed. Each of the black ones is a VM, so it's 5 VMs. and you have already virtualized physical or cable connected in virtual box set up with two tenants, you have two gateways, where you can also test VPN stuff, like I said, with two IPs in parallel, and remote target, and Ansible will provide you this configuration. That's what my Apple setup is doing. I have readmes how to use that on GitHub as well. I have to hurry up, sorry about that. It's still using Sudo. I will update later on. I found out how it's, how it has to be done to change it to US. And the vagrant file will be generated from Ansible, or you can use provided from GitHub, and if you want to adapt it because you maybe have networking conflicts or something. And usually the question here would be like, what about VMD instead of using OS X and so on? Someone might change it. Then Ansible, I'm describing here what the different playbooks are doing. If you have never used Ansible, there was a tutorial yesterday from Benedict, and I really recommend, if you haven't been using Ansible before, to read that first, so you have a rough idea of what's happening. Yeah, so that's just a wrap up for what I've been telling, and use it, and you are too scared to do it on your real boxes, I'm happy if you're using my test environment, because testing, it's really the important thing. And I will extend this part, this SMTF project, that you can fetch a configuration from the live system, push it into this test bed, then you can test your changes there, and push it out to live later on. Okay, thanks. Peter, of course. And Ingo for the presentation, OpenSD, definitely. And Wendy for having a lot of spare time for me to create this talk and this project. And some more links, especially of Peter, and of course, to read my pictures. Very valuable information, all is in there, and anything fails really badly, it's my contact me as well. I can live demo that in lunch break or this evening at Frankfurt, if you want to see that, or if you are already trying it out, it's great. Just hop up to me. So, if there's any questions, otherwise cheer up already for me. Thank you very much. Wow. Oh, okay.
Excuse me. One interface can only print one argument.
Right.
So for the loopback interface cases, you will have to use a pair to connect all the things together to reach that.
Yes.
So the interface can only belong to a single argument.
Yes.
But an argument can have multiple interfaces.
Yes.
So you can. So whenever you put like you have hello one,
you can just invent new loopback interfaces.
Yep. Okay, then you just assign the send the loopback address.
Okay.